First, I want to thank everybody for starting off, not just the day, but the conference with us this morning. And welcome to our panel on the imperative early childhood education. I'm Dr. Elanna Yalow. I am CEO of Knowledge Universe Early Learning Programs. In my role, I get to support the development of all of our curricular programs and look at quality and accreditation, as well as some assessment work that we're doing and work on some policy issues. I'd like to start by introducing our highly esteemed panel that represents a wide variety of interests, all with a focal emphasis on early childhood education. All the way to my right is Governor John Engler, who's president of the Business Roundtable, an association of CEOs of leading U.S. corporations. He's a former three-term governor of Michigan and assumed leadership of the Business Roundtable in January 2011 after serving as president and CEO of the National Association of Manufacturers. Governor Engler is heavily engaged in education and workforce issues, identifying the pressing shortage of skilled employees as a global threat to American competitiveness. Directly to my right is J.B. Pritzker, who is an entrepreneur, investor, and very generous philanthropist. He is co-founder and managing partner of Pritzker Group, a private investment firm. Most relevant to our panel, Mr. Pritzker is an active philanthropist. The Pritzker Family Foundation is a principal backer of the First 5 Years Fund, a national organization to improving the lives of children at risk by leveraging cost-effective investments in early learning. He also helped establish the Pritzker Consortium on Early Childhood Development at the University of Chicago, led by Nobel Prize-winning economist James Heckman. On my left is Linda Smith, who is a Deputy Assistant Secretary, very long title, and Inter-Departmental Liaison for Early Childhood Development, I'm not done yet, for the Administration for Children and Families at the Department of Health and Human Services. In this role, she provides overall policy coordination for the Head Start and Early Head Start program and the Child Care and Development Fund, as well as serving as a liaison with the Department of Education and other federal agencies. Her office serves as a focal point for early childhood policy at the federal level, and I've known Linda for many years, and she is a powerful advocate and voice for children nationwide, and it's just an honor to have her here. And then all the way to my left is John Woodward, who is CEO and one of the founding members of Busy Bees, which operates 250 nurseries in the United Kingdom. Busy Bees opened its first nursery in 1984. Earlier this year, Busy Bees acquired 60 nurseries in Singapore and Malaysia, and I have had the great privilege to work with John for many years and his entire team at Busy Bees, and have seen his personal, very powerful commitment to delivering quality early learning experiences for young children. So with that, I'd like to just give a brief overview to the issues of early childhood education. First, if I could show slide one, please. So slide one is just an overview of Knowledge Universe. You can see that we operate three brands, best known for our KinderCare Early Learning Centers. It is the largest provider of high-quality early learning experiences in the private space for education. We serve close to about 150,000 children in our KinderCare centers. We also partner with businesses through our CCLC brand, working with about 100 of the nation's leading corporations. And then we have a Champions brand, which supports school-age programs in partnership with school districts around the nation. But we're really here not to talk about any one offering, but to really talk about the importance of early childhood education. I'd just like to show a few slides to frame that issue. If we could turn to slide three, please. So this is a slide that actually points to synapse development in young children. And you can see the shaded area of children between birth and 12 months of age. And synapses are actually the neural pathways of the brain. And you can see during the child's earliest years the very rapid growth of neural pathways of a child's brain. This neuroscience research has really accelerated our focus on the importance of early childhood education. Not that children's brains don't continue to develop after these critical periods, but it is really a key time in terms of brain formation and laying the foundation for a child's future success. If you could turn to slide four. And here we focus significantly on language development. This is really critical research that was done originally in the mid-1990s, that looked at language exposure of young children. And what this slide shows is a significant differential in terms of exposure to language from children from more affluent homes versus children from lower income homes. And just mapping the amount of language exposure is one thing, but the graph on the right actually points to the differential impact impact in terms of children's language development, their cumulative vocabulary, beginning even at 12 months, you start to see those curves move apart from each other. And by 36 months, a significant differential in terms of the cumulative vocabulary of children based on the degree of language exposure. Now, one thing that's really important to emphasize is it's not just a count of words. Obviously, that's what this research focused on and what we learned a great deal from. It is also the quality of the language the children are exposed to that is really essential in promoting their language development. And third grade reading, which we often talk about as a gateway skill, is highly correlated with children's language development as young as 3 years of age. The last slide I'd like to turn to is slide 5, please. This is a pretty famous slide. It's often shown at this conference in talking about human capital more generally. It was research done by James Heckman that points to the importance of investing in children at the earliest ages. In fact, the highest rate of return on investments in human capital come if you invest in children at their earliest ages. You can see that as the shaded area in 0 to 3. So there is a confluence of factors from neuroscience to child development to economics that point to the critical role of a child's earliest years in ensuring their success in school and in later life. And with that, I'd like to turn to all of our panelists and ask them to the title of the panel is Early Childhood Imperative. I'd like to ask first if you actually support that and feel that early childhood is an imperative, and then really speak to how you got interested or your relationship with early childhood education and how your work supports it. So if I could start with JB, if you'd like to lead us off.
Well, I came at this as a businessman from the perspective not of, kind of a bleeding heart, you know, let's do what we can for the children, but rather what attracted me to it was really the work of Jim Heckman, small investments in very, very young children can have enormous impact on our fiscal situation from local, state, and federal government perspective, as well as economic growth and jobs. So, you know, I scratched my head when I began researching this, wondering, why aren't we doing more? And there are an awful lot of reasons why not. A lot of it has just been structural. People just haven't, you know, at the government level, most politicians don't understand this issue. Most politicians, frankly, don't have anybody lobbying them on this issue because the constituency for this, of course, we're talking about low-income children. The constituency for this are, you know, very young, poor children and their parents who don't vote and don't have any money. And politicians, as we know, are mostly interested in money and votes. Maybe we'll ask Governor Engler to elaborate on that. So the result is there's nobody showing up really at their offices on a regular basis and threatening their reelection in any, you know, real way. So as a political matter, this has been, you know, one of those subjects that does not have an advocate and therefore does not get the light of day. The K-12 world is ever-present, ever-powerful, mainly because of the unions and now because of the reform movement. But it doesn't focus on early childhood either. But all the research shows, and you just saw a few slides, that investments in very early childhood actually have a much greater impact on K-12 than the investments that you make in K-12. And yet, somehow that gets lost. So I view myself as a businessman philanthropist who is trying to elevate the subject matter, who's trying to invest in scalable programs to make sure that when and if the government ever comes to this subject, then we will have the answers, and we do, by the way. So we can elaborate on what the answers are, and of course, everybody around here. I want to just make one other point, and then I'll pass it back. But Linda, in her position, in my opinion, ought to be elevated to maybe a new title. I've always thought that.
Shorter. We could just add it on.
Shorter.
Exactly. We'll just take one of the words. But actually, the word I would focus on, and maybe we should pick another one because I know this has been much maligned, but czar. We need an early childhood czar. This interdepartmental, you know, the problem is early childhood is a confluence of two departments, really, the education department and HHS. And there's an office in each one. I mean, historically, there was an office in each one, and they didn't really talk to one another. And more recently, there is now this position that Linda occupies. But this subject matter is going to, if we focus on it, will truly change education in America. We will, the impact on not just the education system, but also on our economy is enormous, and we can get into some detail of that going forward. But I just wanted to say, Linda, if you don't end up with that title, I still think we ought to create that title and that position and someone who truly can direct the resources to make big impact here.
Thank you, JB. Okay. Governor, would you like to?
Sure. I've certainly gotten interested in these issues over a long period of time because I had a long career in the legislature in Michigan before being elected governor back at the end of the last century. But during that tenure, those 12 years, we spent a lot of time in the mid-90s, we were very much involved in welfare reform. We were trying to help people break that cycle of poverty, which was, even then, we were looking at, in some cases, third generation or even longer in extreme cases. So there's no doubt that the education system is the key, because today we've got a U.S. economy that doesn't have very much capacity to absorb unskilled workers. And that's almost true in any sector. There's not real opportunities for unskilled individuals today. So we have to change that. I want to help validate the investments that have been made now in early childhood in increasing amounts, really, in recent years. Now, Head Start's been around for a long time. I mean, everybody will cite the Perry School in Ypsilanti, Michigan, as the seminal study that was done way back when. But, you know, we've gone billions of dollars past that over the years. And what we need to be able to show, I think, with all of the investments, because by now we should have schools where children are coming. If you think about early child, part of it is the premise is that the child comes to school ready to learn. Learn what? Well, first up probably is reading. Can the child learn to read? And so if the child hits kindergarten, having been sort of amped up with preschool investments, we should have examples now that we can point to in the country where all the children are learning to read, and they're proficient in doing so, regardless of background. Mm-hmm. But the NAEP test, which is the, you know, the education department that JB was just talking about, they do a study, and we have a 64% non-proficient rate of reading at the end of third grade. In other words, 36% is all that's proficient. So we've got to figure out, has anybody in America cracked the code? Where is it being done? Where are all kids learning to read? Because another department over at NIH, they've done some studies that are very impressive that say, yes, we know how to teach reading to kids. They had 15,000 kids in that study. So my interest is, how do we make early childhood investment pay off? And the only measurement that I think that we should, or the single measurement, because there's been a big debate in education about high standards, about Common Core. Well, this is all before this starts. I mean, because Common Core is really fourth grade on up. So where are the success stories, and what do we need to replicate them? How did they deliver the early childhood education? Who showed up at the parents' home when the baby came home from the hospital that made a difference? What got done to get these kids reading? Conversely, if despite all of that, there's no solution that we can point to, then maybe we need a little bit of a reset in terms of how we're thinking about this to get it done. So I'm interested in helping to validate the investment that we're making in order to get children educated, in order to break the cycle of poverty, and have the next generation of America's youth growing up able to be educated and skilled so they can go into the workforce to help drive the country forward. Nothing less important than that. So there you have it. That's why I'm here, Elanna.
So that sounds like imperative. Thank you, Governor. And if we could just quickly turn to slide 2, I believe. This, not to disrupt the flow, but this actually points to some of the statistics that the governor was talking about some of the challenges that our children have in terms of performance on the NAEP, but frankly, the children are showing up at kindergarten with already significant performance gap. With that, I'd like to turn it over to Linda for your perspective.
Well, I want to start with a couple of things on this one, and I'd like to go to slide 9, if you would. And this just illustrates what Yalow has been saying. And if you look at this, this is the first 2 years of life in the brain development that occurs. And these are, you know, what is happening as the brain forms its connections. The thing that I want to point to here is this is by 2 years of age. And so if we get to this issue of what happens if these connections don't get made is the question this country needs to start asking itself. Because if these connections are not formed on time and on target, then what do we have? Well, we obviously have a problem that by the time children get to kindergarten, they are not ready. And that is, in fact, what's happening in so many of our children, and especially our low-income children. So what does that mean, then, in terms of real common sense to this country? Well, it means we're going to invest in programs, then, that to try and fix this. And those programs, and JB knows this, he's been working on some issues around this, they are special education, remedial education, and a lot of these other programs that are high cost and actually questionable in terms of how much we can fix of when this doesn't occur at the proper time. So I want to go to slide 11 and say, is this an imperative? Well, yes, it is, because I think JB actually also brought this up in terms of what we are investing in this country is inversely related to the impact that programs have on children's development and on that first slide. So if you look at that slide, we are roughly investing about $300 per capita per child in this country on a child in the very first 2 years of life. That previous slide where we showed those neural connections, that's our investment in this country. And then that investment goes up with age. Now we should be doing, if you go back to Yolanda's slide, we should be doing exactly the opposite. Our greatest investment should start at the birth to 3 time period and then move down. And we are not doing that. Now, the question is, why aren't we doing it? Well, obviously, we haven't created the political will in this country yet to take a look at this and to know what needs to be done. There have been some cases where this has been done, and one of them, I'll go back to my own experience with the Department of Defense. And the Department of Defense did fix its early childhood program about 15 or 20 years ago. And what happened there was they made an investment in early childhood that basically matched the parents, what the parents paid dollar for dollar. And that's what it took to change that system. Now, you can say, well, why does DOD care about this? Well, one of the facts, and I think as business people, if you are in business in this country, you have to think like the military did so many years ago, and that was, we recruited in those days roughly half of the active duty military from families of military. So they knew that if they didn't train them and fix this early, they were going to end up training them later on. So the investment that DOD made was, in many ways, a selfish investment. It was all about decreasing the training and the needs that they had when they recruited soldiers into active duty from these families. So I think what we do have some models of what has worked. I want to just make one point, and then I'll give Please. This back to you.
You never interrupt
and
us.
That is that, you know, I think there's been a lot of discussion in the country as to whether or not Head Start works. Well, Head Start does work, and let me just be clear on that. Our children coming out of our Head Start programs arrive at kindergarten on a par with their peers. Now, what happens in K through 3 is another story. And if you go back to the pruning of the brain, and that's what the neuroscientists call it when the neurons fall away and the connections don't form, I loved hearing Dr. Walter Gilliam from Yale described this, because what he said was, if you take a seedling and you water it and you put it in the sun and you fertilize it, it grows. So what happens when we get to kindergarten and it withers? Whose problem is that? And I think that we have to examine that K through 3 space at the same time we are looking at early childhood. But Head Start, when it is done well, and it is done well for the most part in this country, is producing the outcomes that we want to see for our children. They are arriving at school ready to learn. So I'm going to turn it back over to Yalow.
Thank you. So John, you have a slightly different perspective, having worked both in the UK and now in Singapore, Malaysia. Can you give a perspective? It seems like other countries are making a more significant investment in early childhood education.
So do I apologize before I start? Or, yeah. I think it's really interesting being in America and having this discussion. When I was 18, so 42 years ago, it took me about 3 months to read some of the work of the Chicago Institute, which clearly demonstrated all those years ago that if you invest in early years, it gives you that payback. However, that payback is more than two political terms. So, very difficult to spend the money then and create votes to get you back into power. That's my cynical view. I think America's got to do something now. It's been a long time in the UK. We're the largest provider, private provider, in the UK, the Netherlands, Singapore, and Malaysia. And we get a perspective of what governments act like. And particularly in Asia, you don't have this debate. Everybody's bought into the idea. Asia, families spend more money and more disposable income on education than pretty well everywhere, more in Korea than anywhere, but across Asia. Because they know that the way that they are going to become a power as they go forward is through education. Singapore is a great place to be because it understands human capital. Now, if you look at that slide and say, so does America lead the way? Well, no, but it should. Because America, probably before anybody else, was actually explaining the reasons for investing in early years, and now it doesn't. The debate, I mean, you know, the UK is an interesting place to be at the moment, because you have to ignore what any politician tells you for the next few weeks, because it makes me laugh. We normally export comedy, don't we, to the States? So I think we've just forgotten that the politics shouldn't actually be that soap opera. And the stuff that is being promised now is nonsense. What they're saying is, let's give people more hours per week for their early years, but no more money. So it actually cuts the hourly rate, which means that it puts the practice into jeopardy, which is just nonsense. They'll become better when the 14 parties who have to create the alliance for our future all sit down and become sensible, it won't change very much. One of the problems in the UK is, who do you vote for? Well, there's not much difference. And who makes the least mistakes on the 2 weeks up to the election is probably the winner. That's sad, isn't it? In Singapore and in Malaysia, and even in the Netherlands, which has made some huge mistakes on how they structure early years, they've got it. They understand that they have to invest. Their big issue is how. And if you can throw the politics away, there are some answers sitting there. There are some answers which bring together for-profit and not-for-profit. You know, we're one of the largest providers in the world, but what we do is not the answer for the world. It's just a part of it. And if we work together for the for-profit, not-for-profit, what's good for children, then there are some answers, and there's some answers there to copy. Don't worry about making it up. Just go and copy something which is good. And some of those things are there. And Elanna, we've seen them. And so the obstacles are in people's heads. They're not money, and they're not knowledge, because we've got it. And if we can bang people's heads together, and I don't know what you do. Do you? I'm a sad person that quite likes the confrontation. So mine would be upset people, challenge them, make them embarrassed into actually looking at what the obvious thing is. Because the common sense, pleasant, gentle view means you just slip further and further behind. And the people who are able to make good decisions, You know, perhaps we all need a benevolent dictatorship because it gives us time to put some things in operation. But I think you have to be more confrontational. Perhaps it's because I like it. But I think you have to be more confrontational because the nice bit of quiet academics talking about justification, well, we'll be having this conversation in 10 years. So let's rattle a and perhaps I'd be a good person to do that because I don't, you know, it doesn't matter. Yeah. You know, I don't matter because I'm from that little place near Europe. But we have the organisational expertise and we know what the results are. So all this stuff is like smoke and mirrors.
How do you know what results are?
Well, if you look at some of the studies that have taken place, if you go back all that time, you know the answer, you just gave me the same time. If you look at that, you know, I'm not worried what the number is, and we can talk in dollars. I mean, I now talk in rupees as well and ringgits and everything else. But, you know, somewhere the number is, for every dollar you spend in those first 5 years, you'll get $20 or $30 or $50 back in later life. Well, if it's 10, it's good enough. One thing I think we make a mistake on is, and academia doesn't help. Everybody's looking for a perfect answer, and everybody's worrying about upsetting the 5%, and therefore you don't do anything. So my view is more simplistic. Get on with it. Get on with it. Do some of the things. We started a business 30 years ago for our own children. Sold our houses, lived above the first one, because we believed if we campaigned for it, you know, we'd never see it. You know, and I think that would have been true. So we went off and did it, and what we did wasn't perfect, and it didn't provide for everybody, but it gave something to look at and criticize or replicate and do it. And that's there. But I just think, I don't know, perhaps you've just got to be more obnoxious. And that doesn't fit academia. Because they're generally pleasant people. So perhaps some of the business people are the right people to head it because they can be objectionable.
I want to add a couple of points to what John said there, because one of the things that I think we are exporting in this country is our knowledge. Most, if you ask anyone in early childhood, most of the brain, the neuroscience, most of the research, the brain research, what was referred to with the Perry preschool, the research is coming out of the United States. We're not using it. Most other civilized countries are. And that is a shame on us, in my view, that we are not using our own knowledge.
Jim Heckman, who by the way, is the one who, one of the ones who did the studies that show the returns mm-hmm. on investing in early childhood, is more popular and more well known in China and in Colombia than he is in the United States. I mean, it's which is crazy, right? I mean, we are truly developing all the research and proof, and then others are putting it to work, and we're not.
That's right.
You know, there was a slide that you pulled up, Linda, that I want to re-pull up, and I think it was slide 9. I'm not sure the one.
9, 11.
No, it's 11. Sorry, 11. If you would. So, you know, that one I just want to highlight for everybody is how bass-ackwards, you know, we are in the United States on this subject. It's not that we shouldn't be spending in kindergarten through 12th grade. It's just that if you want to get, you know, the amount of money and its required expenditure, the amount of money that gets spent on special education in the United States is enormous, and it occurs in those later years there. And it occurs in large part, in my opinion, because we don't provide preschool and we don't provide programs in 0 to 3. There is now, because of the lack of funding, and of course at every level of government there's a fiscal crisis, there are now developing in the United States, coming out of the UK, social impact bonds, pay for success bonds. Which are at least a beginning to an answer for the politicians, if you ask me, about early childhood. It provides the opportunity for private investors to invest in programs for early childhood and get a return on that, while the taxpayer is getting about 90% of the return. The investors are getting maybe 10% of the return. At least, although there's a sharing that occurs, and there are some people that object to the idea that, you know, some government money might end up in the hands of private investors, it is probably the best current way that we're going to expand early childhood. It isn't, you know, the only way. It's not going to take care of all of the need. In fact, not even a majority of the need. But it is at least one method that can be used to expand the amount of money that's brought into early childhood until the politicians and all of us make sure that government is flipping this on its head, this slide.
So I'd like to come back to social impact bonds, but first, the governor asked John a question about accountability, and I'd love to hear the panelists more broadly discuss that. We know all the returns and all the great things that accrue from high-quality early childhood education depends on high quality, and simply putting children in group care doesn't yield those benefits. So my question to the panelists is, there a sort of point of view on what does quality look like? How do we know if we have quality in early childhood education? We look at ratios, staff qualifications, should it be kindergarten readiness? Is it third grade reading? What are the right proof points for early childhood?
Well, I actually think you have to, I mean, we're having a lot of conversation about how we measure the inputs, how much we're spending at what level and how politicians allocate and, you know, graphs like that. But what output should we measure? How do we know? I mean, you mentioned the preschool works, okay? What is there any K through 3 school in America that took this prepared Head Start graduate and is now succeeding? Is there one? And who would it be? Mm-hmm. Do we have one example in our nation? Because we're saying basically the whole nation has failed. We're not sitting here citing, because the one thing I know about politicians is that they actually like to copy things that work. Mm-hmm. School systems don't, but politicians do. Mm-hmm. Elected officials like to have winning ideas. And so if there was a school system or something out there that was a result, I think you've got to look at outcomes. I mean, I think input debate is fine, but to what end? And I personally think that the thing that America needs to wake up to is the, and I'm guessing, and John would know this, but I'm thinking Asian kids are learning to read. Yep. I'm thinking the Netherlands kids are probably learning to read. And 64% of our kids are not proficient in reading. You know, so the question is it just, what are we doing wrong? And how do we get an answer to that question? And it seems to me, the whole going to school ready to learn, the first thing I'll learn is you gotta be good at reading. Because we know that break point between third grade and fourth grade is pretty darn important for the rest of one's life. And I just don't believe that if somebody doesn't get anything, that we've doomed them. There's gotta be a way. I mean, we wanna do as much as we can for as many as we can.
They're not doomed. I mean, to me, this is you're never going to get 100% of the outcome that you want with the input of early childhood. So, I mean, just to be clear, there's no school that you'll look at with third grade reading scores where every kid is proficient, at least not low-income kids in the United States. It's just not happening. What is happening, though, and studies, plenty of studies have shown this, that you get a much better outcome as a result of investing in early childhood at third grade reading scores. I'm a big believer in measuring, big believer in that, and I agree with you. And we haven't done a ton of that in the United States. Third grade reading scores, I'm sure you know this probably better than anybody, third grade reading scores are the best predictor of incarceration rates in the United States. That's scary. But it does tell you if we can fix the problem that you're describing, or at least get closer to a fix, we're going to have a big impact on public expenditures, let's say.
Well, I just think it's a question if everybody knew the answer to that. I don't know. You know, we've got a lot of parents in the audience. We've got, you know, kids who go through school. I mean, we should know about every elementary school in America, the kids learn to read or not. And when they are learning to read, we might say, well, what happened in that school? Was it the high-quality preschool? Was it the high-quality Head Start program? Was it a combination factor? Was it just really involved parents who got it done? I mean, a lot of this is workaround for family units that aren't pretty fractured, pretty fragile. Mm-hmm. But not all of it, because we can look at two-parent families in suburban America in their schools, and they're not all proficient in reading. And we can also look at the grandparents' generation and see that in many cases, we were better at teaching reading to the earlier generations. even setting aside race and income levels. I mean, so it's kind of an interesting conundrum that we've got.
I think some of those things are there. I mean, Singapore is a good example, because Singapore's large enough and small enough to be a viable case study.
Yeah,
so you can look at it and say, so how has that country developed its education system, and why are people doing so well academically, in those teenage, going to university and whatever. One of the problems, I'm old enough to go, we've been through the phase of, let's not test any child because, somebody might look better than somebody else. Well, let's grow up and actually do something and say, this is for the child's benefit to look at what we should be doing. So we should be measuring. We shouldn't be then labeling everybody. I mean, that's all sort of obvious stuff. But we should be measuring, because unless you measure, how do you decide what they need? So I think you're right. You should be doing it. One of the issues, I think, is the term. One of the best things in the UK, I mean, we made some real big mistakes. One of the best things in the UK, we adopted a 10-year plan. So therefore, nobody could really mess for 10 years. And it wasn't always right. There were things in that plan but it was a good thing, because everybody who was trying to deliver knew the ground rules for the next 10 years, and actually we got somewhere. We then looked at the things that we got wrong, and then created the next plan. So it wasn't perfect, but the development in that time and the focus in that time were about outcomes. And so, the national curriculum was all about outcomes. But, I ran a therapeutic community for intelligent disturbed kids, and the worst behavior in the UK of children. And if you wanted to change that at teenage behavior, you needed to go back to the early years, because by the time they'd got to school, they'd already were labeled as disruptive kids, because they hadn't been given some of those skills, so they failed, and they were clever enough to destroy the whole classroom that they were in. So it's not just that education bit, it's the behavior change as well. And the cost of dealing with that group of children in later life is just staggering compared to investing in the early years.
I'd like to share some data on slide 6 just very quickly, just from our own programs. This is a study we did. Actually, the state of Maryland did the study for us, but we wanted to look at the impact of our children on their kindergarten readiness exams, because they have a comprehensive data system. And what these data show is the blue bars are children statewide in the state of Maryland. The orange slides are children who attended our program for any period of time and who left our program in pre-K. And then the light blue slide all the way on the right, that actually shows how children performed on a kindergarten readiness exam in the state of Maryland who had been with us for more than 1 year and were full-time children. So we do see that even in a relatively short period of time, increased dosage or exposure to high-quality early learning programs can make a difference on kindergarten readiness. I think to Linda's point, we then have to think about what happens to those children after they leave high-quality early learning environments.
Can we go I'd like to go from that to slide 12. And this just, not to belabor the point of what's wrong in this country, but this is very important for people to understand about what's going on in the United States. In any given week in the United States, we have about 11 million children under the age of 5 in some form of non-parental child care. The two graphs on the side show what the quality of that is. Now, we can discuss and we can describe what quality looks like. But if you look at that, 93% of children in family child care homes, that's our home-based programs in this country, are in mediocre to poor quality. And that is a really serious issue. And then look at the number in center-based care. Only a quarter of children are in high quality. Now, what is high quality? Well, generally speaking, it's fairly easy to look at this. And I would ask Yalana to jump in on this. But if you look at the quality of care or of programming, it all hinges on the workforce. And what we have not done in this country is invest in our early childhood workforce. They are underpaid, they are undertrained, they turn over at a fairly high rate. And so we can't expect to get really, you know, substantial and high, you know, great outcomes with that situation going on. So if you go back to that slide where we showed the $300 investment, what are we getting for the $300? That's what we're getting, is it substantially mediocre to poor quality programs for our children in this country. And that's where we've got to invest. So if you invest in the workforce, you stabilize the workforce, you pay them properly, and you get them trained and educated, the quality will go up. And it really is that simple. The single biggest indicator of high quality early care and education is the quality of the adult-child interaction in a program. Going back to some of the slides that Yalana showed about language, if a child is not talked to, how do we expect them to learn language? And then what do we expect that they will, how they will be reading it at third grade? These things all connect, and that slide in terms of the quality of the programs in the United States is criminal to what's going on, and it is what needs to get fixed. So why then do we have a problem with that? Why is the pay so low, the turnover so high? Because in this country, we are depending almost entirely on the parents to pick up the cost. And it actually, as I say, it costs more to produce high quality early care and education than parents can afford to pay. We look at, in HHS, we think the average cost of a high quality infant space in this country should be somewhere around $12,000 to $13,000. In DC or here in LA, that's gonna be $18,000. If you are a parent making basically even 200% of poverty, you are looking at almost, you know, 40% of your income going to pay for that. And they can't afford it. So what happens? Kids go to poor quality. So what we really need to figure out is the gap between what parents can afford to pay and who is going to pay the cost to get that quality up, to pay those teachers, to stabilize the workforce, and to get those teachers educated and trained. You can't expect someone with an eighth grade education to understand the neuroscience that we've been showing you here.
I want to challenge a little bit the center-based notion, because there's really going to be a much smaller percentage of kids that end up in center-based care than end up in a home or in some friends, family, and neighbor type care. And so the question I think that we're facing, because I don't think anybody here thinks that we can spend $18,000 per child. I mean, I think that's a very hard number to get to from where we are today. Let's just say it that way. And so the question is, are there scalable programs, and particularly as you look at 0 to 2 there, are there scalable programs that address the challenges? And, you know, your brain synapses slide, you know, gets to this, that are either scalable, affordable, and that begin to move the needle. And there are, you know, lest people think that everything is about preschool when you're talking 0 to 5, you know, there are lots of home visitation, there's parent education. These are things that we don't invest in the United States. And yet it's hugely important. Parents who get a visit at home or even in the hospital from a caregiver or someone who's knowledgeable provides them not only with information about what they can do with their child, like talk to them regularly, which many parents oddly don't know, but also can give them access to all the programs that exist at the state and local level that are available to them that they otherwise didn't know about. And those programs, they already exist. We're already spending money on them. They are not, you know, sometimes widely disseminated as they ought to be. Home visitation helps a lot with that. So parent education, home visitation, and then, you know, there's a program like Healthy Steps where if you can't actually get to everybody's home, and certainly Nurse Family Partnership, which does a terrific job, but it's hard to scale because it's very expensive. You know, every parent does interact with a physician at some point or another and on a somewhat regular basis, particularly because we have universal child care in the United States, I mean child health in the United States. So they are interacting with a physician, and in those physicians' offices, if there were a trained nurse person who works in that office, not a new person, but just someone who already works there that gets additional training, you could have a similar effect as home visitation. I'm just trying to give a picture for people in the audience here of, you know, how does one address these issues that seem mostly to exist in one's home, but they're not getting addressed. And you can do it on a scalable, relatively cost-effective fashion. It's not everything we need, but we don't even have those things.
Well, I was just going to say that one of the things that we are looking at, and we were talking about this earlier, is we have Congress just appropriated $500 million last year, and we are in the process of looking at the early Head Start, what we call early Head Start child care partnerships, in an effort to raise, use the lessons that we know from the Head Start program and transfer them into child care to address some of the quality issues we have. One of the things, and this is, you know, I always have to do this little hand jive thing here, but we know at the federal level we are spending roughly $13,000 on an early Head Start space. Okay, that's a full day, year round space. On the child care side, with our child care and development fund money that goes for low income children, generally speaking, at about poverty, maybe up to 150% of poverty, we are spending on average $5,500 a space. So what can you buy for $5,500? Well, really not much. I mean, if you do math, and we say in generally early childhood 1-to-4 ratio of children to adults is the standard in this country, we are putting our workers into poverty by what we're paying them at $5,500. That's exactly poverty level wages. So what we're doing with the partnerships is trying to close the gap by transferring contracting from Head Start into child care and paying the child care provider at a rate similar to the Head Start, to see if we can raise the standards and stabilize the care and the early learning going on in those programs. I think it's yet to be determined. We're going to study that. But we have somehow got to close this gap between what it costs and what it, you know, and what we're paying for it. And it can't be on the backs of parents. They simply can't afford it at the wages that many of our parents are making. So I think that's one of the challenges. I would second what you said, JB, in that I get very frustrated when people think that there's a single solution to a very complex problem. And it is a complex problem, and it does involve, we need to work with parents more. We need better parent education programs in this country. Home visiting definitely is starting to pay off. But, you know, a single solution is not the answer to this. And I don't want anybody to leave this room thinking that it's going to be a quick issue.
I don't think there is a single solution, because we're a pretty diverse country and communities are very diverse. On the other hand, I'd like to know that a single solution has been found somewhere in America, turning it around, you know. And I think of John's comments on Singapore. I mean, the D.C. public schools probably are, on an expenditure basis, you know, between $25,000 a year, you know, I mean, or in that range. And so if there were a Head Start program at $13,000, if there were early childhood at $5,500, plus other, you know, we're doing the society makes quite a commitment here. We don't organize this very well, and we don't have very much accountability along the way. But I'm thinking, if John had that kind of money for some of the kids who are in some of the programs in some of the places where he's running, I don't know how much his company would be making, but I suspect you'd have a pretty solid program and
I think
a couple of dollars left over.
I think
at that investment level.
We actually asked the parents what they want, which is a good start. And I mean, it's obvious what I wanted, because we started a children's nursery and we wanted daycare from an early age, and it was great. But that's not the answer for everybody. And I think people do want choices. Psychologically, they don't want somebody to tell them what they should be doing. You know, so you've got to provide some of those choices, give them the information to be able to make some of those choices, which is what they want. But perhaps this isn't...
One of our challenges, John, is we've got at least a portion of this population, they are stay-at-home moms because they're on public assistance and not able to work. We haven't been able to make the stay-at-home mom into a caregiver who could okay, while you're home and we're hoping to get you back to, connected to the workforce, could you help us on, you know, you may not have great literacy skills, but if you're if you've been trapped in this system, can you help work this out?
I'd love to open it up to the audience if we could. Sorry. Just in case there's any questions. Yeah. Otherwise, we could come back. Any questions from the audience for the panel? There's a microphone. Excuse me. Sorry, gentlemen.
I've come to many sessions like this over the years about the importance of early childhood education. And every time there's a very competent panel like you guys, and you generally say the same things, and there's good data that supports it, and we all leave here, and probably some of us like me are frustrated, but then we have the panel again next year. How do we get, I don't know if it's the politicians or who it is, to attend these sessions instead of us and figure this out so that we do something with that chart so that we're not spending $300 and instead we're spending, I don't know the number, but it's obviously not 300, 3,000 or 5,000 and fix this. I've been involved for almost 20 years on a board that involves resource and referral for child daycare. It is a remarkably complex and difficult problem, and it leads to exactly that thing you pointed out where 97% of the kids are, they don't have it, whether it's bad care or their parents are at home, but what the parents are doing is turning on the television set and not really doing anything. How do we, I know I'm just going to leave here and go to the next session like everybody else, and we'll see you guys again next year. How do we, seriously?
Oh, we're working on it.
But JB, what are you?
Well, I guess maybe on the optimistic side of this, having been involved with it for 15 years, or 17 years, there's been progress. I recognize that's not, you know, satisfactory progress or fast enough. There's been a lot of progress. I mean, this subject was never talked about in Congress. I mean, it was like nobody ever talked about this before. Now you have presidential candidates making this a plank of their campaigns. And by the way, these programs, these, you know, $500 million programs that get passed, social impact bonds, for example, are actually coming into sort of mainstream thought in the Congress. All of this because people are beginning to recognize how important early childhood is. They still have all the constituency problems, you know, where, you know, people are lobbying them the other way. Oddly, in many cases, and, you know, this is unfortunate, there are unions that actually lobby against early childhood funding. K-12 unions that lobby against early childhood. But they're not really going in and saying, don't do that. It's just when it comes time for appropriations, they're in there arguing that the money ought to go this way and not to early childhood. So, but that's the negative side. The positive side is that there's much more discussion and, frankly, a little more action on it. You say, well, you know, how aren't we just going to be here next year having the same conversation? And the answer is, it depends. If everybody in this room, frankly, got up, and there are politicians walking the halls, maybe some in this room, who are elected officials, and actually stopped one of them and said, this is a priority. I'm going to vote and give money based on this. That would make a big difference. I mean, you don't think it would, but believe me, I'm sure that Governor Engler would admit that, you know, if 20 people actually stopped a politician and said something on a subject, they're going to pay attention. It matters an awful lot. The problem is that, you know, everything else is a higher priority seemingly to all of us. But just the, what are there, 50 people in this room? If we, you know, 70 people in this room, if we walked out of here and called our congressman or ran into the state rep or the state assemblyman and said something about it, it would make a big difference.
I think you want to comment. We'll go ahead and take another question.
I was going to say we're almost out of time. We only have about 5 minutes left. So maybe for part of closing comments to maybe answer that question. So it's 2020 now, 5 years out to the future. What do you think we will see in early childhood education, and what would you like for us to see? And if everybody could just maybe speak for that a minute.
I don't even have to wait 20 years. Next year, I'd like to see some people here who've got programs that work to answer the gentleman's question. There ought to be examples of things. I mean, I don't know what JB's greatest success is in 15 years of investing, but what program, what result are you most proud of? Where is it made? You know, do we have some place in America? I'm part of the NEKC Foundation as well. We've spent a lot of money on a fight against poverty at a community basis, trying to understand what will work as strategies. In back in Michigan, in special education, the federal law is age 3 to 21. The Michigan law is birth, you know, to 25. So we went further on the front end and on the back end. That also hasn't, you know, resulted in turning the ship. Even on our per capita number, obviously that's per capita. If you, you know, there's a lot of kids don't need, you know, my three daughters didn't, you know, wouldn't qualify, didn't need. They're in the math there, but we are spending more on higher poverty populations, not nearly as much as I think advocates would argue, but of all that we spend and wherever we spend, do we have anything that works? Anything to show? That's kind of what you're asking. Is there anything, all these conversations, well, it's going to be solved at the local and the state level. I don't think Washington's going to get it done because the delivery, I mean, look at the Common Core debate we've had. You've got to fight this out locally. But come on, there's got to be somebody in America who's been able to put this together. And it is true. Singapore is about, what, 5 million people now? Five million. Let's say. So size of a lot of states are that size. They did it in their nation. We can't figure it out in the state.
Thank you, Governor.
I'm going to challenge that. There are programs that work. Educare, for example. Hugely successful. The numbers that were put up on what you're doing at Knowledge Universe are, they look roughly like that for Educare, and that's really focused on the poorest kids. So there are plenty of programs. Now, I talked about a couple of scalable programs that exist. The issue is you're not seeing them scaled. So you're not seeing, so there's only a couple of ways to do that. Philanthropy can't do it alone. And government has to step in and be a partner with philanthropy to do it, and it isn't. So I just want to say I disagree with the premise that we don't know what works. We actually do know what works. We're just not able to scale it.
Yeah, I would add to what JB said. I think that we do know what works, and there are plenty of examples. And I would go to Educare. I would go to what you saw in Knowledge Learning. I would go to Head Start. I mean, we've got many, many examples of what works. What we really need, and I would hope to see in 5 years, is that this country has the political will to do something about it and to take some of these things to scale. And that really does mean a public investment of funds. I mean, there's no way around it. If parents can't pay it, then somebody's going to have to, or we're going to be caught in this do loop until who knows when. So I think really I would hope that our politicians would stand up and do the right thing. It's not going to happen at one time. It's going to happen over a period of time, and it's going to have to be gradual. But we need to start making the down payment to get us to where we need to go, and we need to do that sooner than later.
I think the people who can afford to pay should pay. Our model that we developed in the Netherlands is we're looking to try and get 25% support for all parents, but the parents who can afford to pay the 75% should. You know, perhaps that's a political statement, they should, because there's no way of funding everybody. So if you then change some of these figures and say 75% is going to be private pay from parents, tough. Aspirational, difficult, but worth it. Asia does that. So if you can do that, and then you can help the people who can't pay because they need 100%. If you can do that, but pick off the friendly faces. It's easy to do it in the Netherlands because of the size of it, or in Singapore, but it's a big place. Pick off the states and make them heroes. And hopefully that will embarrass the people who aren't doing it. Is that not right politics?
I'm not sure what right politics looks like, but with that leading question, it probably goes to another panel. I want to thank my incredible panelists and you for all of your time. And I think we answered one question. There is an imperative for early childhood education. So thank you.